She's a graduate of the University of the West Indies and a fellowship in endocrinology in the UK. She's a well-published professor, fellow of the Royal College, as well as the American College of Physicians. And she is the present head of the Department of Medicine. I think you will agree that Professor Wright Pascoe is well qualified to speak to us on managing obesity. Help me to receive Professor Wright Pascoe. Amazing.
Thank you very much, Professor Dalip Ragoobirsingh, for those very kind words. And I'd like to congratulate the organizers of this 23rd International Conference, and especially, of course, to Professor Morrison for bringing this on. I'll start with the first slide, please. And I'm going to be talking about managing obesity in a 20-minute presentation, and therefore, clearly, I'm going to have to focus on certain things. And the focus is not going to be on beating anorexia, but in fact, managing obesity. I, at this point in time, have no disclosures. Obesity is defined as a BMI greater than 30 kilograms per meter squared, and I'm leaving all the statistics that are present in my abstract because Dr. Copeland did such a wonderful presentation on obesity here in the Caribbean, in Jamaica, and internationally. But in 2000, it was said that, and I quote, obesity should be considered a condition with multiple causes, genetic, cultural, socioeconomic, behavioral, and situational factors all play a role in dietary habits and weight control. And it's a very important concept for us to know that it's just not a matter of what you eat, but there are many, many other factors playing a role in the development of obesity in any one individual and in a population. And as Laurie Dickerson says, like diabetes or hypertension, obesity is in fact a chronic medical condition, and it is one that is rarely cured. Now, the American Medical Association, however, disagrees that it is not a condition, it is a disease. And it was designated as such in, I believe that was in 2007, but that designation stimulated a lot of debate and question as to whether, in fact, obesity is a disease or a condition. Well, the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists says that the characteristics of a disease are really one in which you have an impairment of the normal functioning of some aspects of the body, in which you have characteristic signs or symptoms, in which you have a result, in which there is harm or there is morbidity to the entity affected. And in addition, they say that obesity is an altered physiological and metabolic state in which you have environmental, genetic, and hormonal determinants, all of which results in morbidity and mortality. There is an obesity-centric model of disease. There is impairment of normal function, and that includes appetite dysregulation, abnormal energy balance, endocrine dysfunction, including elevated leptin levels and insulin resistance. There's infertility, there's dysregulated adipokine signaling, there are changes in the endothelial function. Of course, we know there's blood pressure elevation, there's non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, dyslipidemia, and there's systemic and adipose tissue inflammation. So I think that I hope here and now you understand that when you see an obese individual, there are many, many factors taking place in that particular person, and that particular person has a disease and is to be treated as such. Now, we know that obesity increases the risk of diabetes by 57%, increases the risk of hypercholesterolemia by 86%, and increases the risk of hypertension by 64%. And this impairment in body function is anatomic. It relates to the increase in the body fat mass. It results in osteoarthrosis, can cause immobility. There's lymphedema or venous stasis. There's sleep apnea. And then we have the physiological and pathophysiological conditions of diabetes, etc. And there are many, many medical complications of obesity. So this is a disorder that we really need to focus on. It's a disorder that we need to pay attention to, and we need to make the diagnosis in our patients. Because many times when I see an individual and I say, how long now have you been obese? Me? I'm fat? And I'm always amazed They do not recognize obesity, and it is not only the population's fault, it's the primary care physician's fault who did not tell them that they were overweight or obese. Now we know that if we can just reduce weight, we can improve the lipid profiles, osteoarthritis disability, lower all-cause mortality from diabetes and cancer, and of course reduce the blood pressure, improve the glycemic control, reduce the risk of diabetes, and even improve lung function in those individuals who have asthma. But in fact, when we have an obese individual in front of us, we're not attempting to cure them. What we're doing is palliation, okay? And we have a multifactorial approach. We have behavioral therapy, dietary modification, physical activity, exercise. But for the remainder of this, the rest of my time, I'm going to be focusing on pharmacological therapy. And I focus on pharmacological therapy because diet, exercise, and behavioral modification has little success in maintaining weight loss. They will initially lose the weight, but they will gain back the weight. So what are these drugs that we have? Now, these drugs are adjuncts to behavioral therapy, and I apologize for the spelling of behavioral. That's a 3 o'clock in the morning error. There, right, there, so. Right. So we have appetite suppressants, of which you have noradrenergic agents, and we have serotonergic agents. We have adrenergic serotonergic agents, thermogenic agents, digestive inhibitors, fat substitutes, and hormonal manipulation. And when you see the wide variety of drugs that we have attempting to address the multiple problems that occur in persons who have obesity, you can understand that they're probably not going to be very efficacious. So we have phentermine, and I will start with that. It is marketed as Adipex P or Ionamine. It is a norepinephrine-releasing agent, and it causes weight loss of approximately 3.6 kilograms. And this is a drug that has been approved in the United States in the 1960s, but only for short-term use. We have diethylpropion, which is marketed as Tenuate, 75 milligrams per day. It's a norepinephrine-releasing agent. It causes weight loss of approximately 3 kilograms after 6 to 52 weeks, and it's again been around since the 1960s, but only for short-term use. And then we have orlistat, Xenical, which inhibits gastric and pancreatic lipase. And therefore, you lose approximately 30% of the fat that you eat. And this fat is going to be excreted as oil in the stool, and you have to be on a diet that is also low in fat. This is 120 milligrams three times a day, and you will receive weight loss of approximately 3 kilograms after 12 months. But please note that this weight loss may be small, but the risk of conversion from pre-diabetes to diabetes is as much as 37%. And it has been FDA approved since 1999, and this drug can be used for chronic management of obesity. The side effects, of course, we are well aware of them. It's related to the fat in the stool, the cramps, the flatus, the oily discharge, the fecal incontinence, the loss of fat-soluble vitamins. And so my patients will tell me, I am not taking it because of this. But some persons who have been on it for a long period of time, I have patients who have been on it for 5-6 years and have been able to maintain their weight loss for that long period. They must take a multivitamin supplement, however. We have lacosarin, which is marketed in the United States as Belvic, 10 milligrams twice a day. Now, this is an agonist of the serotonin 2C receptor, which works at the hypothalamic area. And you lose approximately 7.9 pounds or 3.6% of your body weight if you use it for more than a year. And it has been FDA approved for use since 2012, and this is for chronic weight management. Then it does have side effects, of course, which is one of the problems with these drugs. Headache, dizziness, fatigue, nausea, dry mouth, constipation. But it doesn't cause the valvulopathy that resulted in a removal of a drug like fenfluramine from the market. Now, I want to talk a little bit about glucagon-like peptide 1. It's a hormone that's produced by the L cells in the small intestine and colon. And it modulates or restricts our feeding duration, how long do you eat for, the proximal GI motility, gastric emptying, and your metabolic responses to nutrient intake. And we use GLP-1 analogs to treat diabetes. So we have our exenatide and we have our liraglutide. But liraglutide has been recently approved by the FDA for the treatment of obesity. And this is a subcutaneous drug, 3 milligrams per day. And the kind of weight loss that you get is 5.8 kilograms greater than the placebo weight loss some 1 year later. And this drug is able to reduce the prevalence of prediabetes and metabolic syndrome by as high as 52 to 59%. It does cause some nausea and vomiting. There is an increased risk of pancreatitis and an increased risk of thyroid C-cell tumors. And when you look at the scale obesity and prediabetes trial, you see that it caused weight loss of approximately 7.2 kilograms, 2.8 kilograms, and and 4.4 kilograms. Now, phentermine, topiramate, which is marketed as Quizmia, has a several dosages, 3.75, 23 combination, 75, 46, 15, 92. And this drug has two mechanisms of action. The topiramate is a GABA receptor modulator, so we're talking about the hypothalamus and the brain. The phentermine is a norepinephrine releasing agent. And the two together cause weight loss of approximately 6.6 kilogram or as high as 8.6% of the body weight. And it has been approved for use in obesity since 2012 and for chronic weight management. You start off with a low dose and then you titrate the dose up, but you must note that after 12 weeks of high dose, if your patient has not achieved 5% weight loss, you should discontinue the drug. It's just not going to work. But you de-escalate the dose gradually so as to avoid seizures. You don't discontinue the drug suddenly. Now, the drug is not to be used in somebody who's going to get pregnant because of the fetal toxicity, and it itself can cause suicide ideation, mood and sleep disorders, and cognitive disorders. We have Contrave, which has bupropion and naltrexone. The bupropion, as you see, stimulates the POM neurons, and it releases alpha-melanocyte and decreases food intake. The naltrexone blocks opioid receptors and suppresses food cravings. And this drug will cause weight loss of approximately 4.8 to 4.8% of the body weight. It's been FDA approved since 2014 for chronic weight management. Again, one of the issues with these drugs is increased suicide ideation and seizure risk, and of course an increase in the blood pressure. Now, if you look at all of the drugs, let's see which ones are most efficacious. We have phentermine, 4 kilogram weight loss. We have diethylpropion, 3.2, Xenical, 3.0 kilogram. Quizmia, 12.2 kilograms, Belvic, 6.2, Liraglutide, 4.4, and Contrave, 6.2. So what did you all notice about these drugs? You're not going to lose 300 pounds, and you're not going to lose 100 pounds on these drugs. These drugs are to be used along with behavioral therapy, diet, exercise, and weight loss. And they are designed to not just reduce weight, but to reduce the metabolic consequences of obesity. And if you look at them, you'll see that some of them are expensive more than others, and some side effect profile are greater than others. So what do we do when we see a patient? If you have a patient who has hypertension, who has a cardiac arrhythmia or seizures, you want to avoid phentermine and diethylpropion, and you use lorcaserin instead, or you use orlistat. You have a patient who has obesity and depression, and they're already on an SSRI or an SNRI, then you want to avoid lorcaserin, otherwise you'll precipitate a serotonin-like syndrome. And you want to use phentermine, topiramate, or phentermine alone, or again, you can use orlistat. If you have a patient who has type 2 diabetes, they're overweight or obese, certainly when you're choosing your anti-diabetic medication, you want to choose one that will promote weight loss. so your GLP-1 analog or your SGLT2 inhibitors, and always, of course, use metformin because it's an anorexiant and it reduces cardiovascular disease in diabetics. And just to remind you, the SGLT2 inhibitors, I know that Patrice mentioned them, but they're the new kids on the block, and maybe many of us are not familiar with them, but we do have these two agents here and now in Jamaica. And by themselves, in diabetics, they cause them to lose approximately 2.3% of their total body weight. So if you have a patient with type 2 diabetes, they're overweight and they're obese, when you're choosing the drugs for glycemic control, try and avoid drugs that cause weight gain. We don't have pramlintide in Jamaica, but it can cause weight gain of 1.4 to 3 kilogram. We have the DPP-4 inhibitors. They tend to be weight neutral. You may want to consider using those drugs. And you may use your alpha-glucosidase inhibitors because they also can cause small change in weight. If you have a type 2 diabetic who requires insulin therapy, you want to reduce the amount of weight that they'll gain with insulin. You certainly want to use insulin and metformin and pramlintide if you had it, or a GLP-1 agonist, which we do have here in Jamaica at this point in time. These drugs are relatively toxic agents. You need to be assessing the efficacy and the safety of the drugs at least monthly for the first 3 months, and then at least every 3 months thereafter. Thank you so much for your attention. And just to remind you of your Trumpism, diabetes has increased dramatically over the past 20 years. That proves that diabetes is caused by global warming. Thank you so much.
In the interest of time, we will proceed to our next speaker. And I'm sure Prof. Rai Pascoe will be around, so she will entertain any questions after the session. Our next speaker is also a graduate of the University of the West Indies. He did his undergraduate medical training at UWE, Mona campus. He's trained in internal medicine at Howard in the US and did complementary graduate studies in the UK and the Netherlands. He is the professor of epidemiology and endocrinology and has been elevated in recent times to director of the Epidemiology Research Unit of the Caribbean Institute for Health Research at UWE. I'm sure you'll recognize that our next speaker is suitably qualified to speak to us on the obesity epidemic. Help me welcome Professor Marshall Tullock-Reed.
All right, so I recognize it's always late. And I've been the last speaker before, so I told Dr. Fitzenly I'll stay till the end. These are my disclosures. And we'll talk a little bit about obesity epidemic. I see Beverly Blake Scarlett is here, so I'll be showing some of her data. We'll talk a little bit about childhood obesity, and then I'm just going to end with some of the things that we're thinking about doing right now in our department, looking at understanding the whole issue of obesity in children, which leads to obesity in adulthood. So these are data from the last national survey. As you'd have heard, we are about completing the current one, but these data, when I showed it to somebody, they said, you know what, you mean overweight and obesity? I said, no, this is just obesity alone. And what you can see here is that in women, by the time most are middle-aged, about 50% of Jamaican women are obese. And of course, the prevalence is a lot higher in women compared to men. So overall, 37% of women and 12% of men. And then if we look at trends in children's weight, these are data going back to the 1960s and then to a study done by Professor Wilkes in 1999, where he's just looking at the mean change in weight among 6-year-olds, 6 to 10-year-olds, and 11 to 15-year-olds. And what you can see is that over that time period, there's been about a 20% increase in weight in the younger age group. And for the boys, about a 30% increase, the girls, about a 25% increase. Of course, for these data, we just had mean weight. We didn't have height, so we can't tell whether the weight for height has changed, but we have some data that we can compare for a little later. And of course, this pattern that we're seeing with a high prevalence of obesity and overweight is common in all age categories. So going back through some of the data that we have in younger age groups, among the 15 to 19-year-olds from the Youth Risk and Resiliency Survey, we see a high prevalence of overweight and obesity, of course, with a female predominance at that age. And then another cohort that we've been following, born in 1986, looking at central obesity, which is really looking at how many people have an elevated waist circumference. Again, you can see a high prevalence of this central obesity with a female predominance. So the data we have for the younger age group is what I'm presenting, so Beverly's data, where she looked at the number of school children in three parishes in the Northeast region. And what she found overall was that about 12% of girls were overweight, 8.7% of boys. And then when you looked at obesity, about 8% of girls were obese, and boys about 6%. So you can see that the overweight obesity trends are starting early, and the sex disparities in obesity prevalence are present from a young age. And of course, just looking at this trend in terms of the prevalence as they age, you can see it increases incrementally with time, especially for obesity, not so much for overweight. And these are the data actually comparing the study that Professor Wilkes had done in 1995 with Beverly's data. And this now will show both for boys and girls, if we're looking at weight adjusted for height, there's definitely been an increase in the body mass index. It's not just a matter of getting bigger, they're definitely getting more obese. And of course, the risk factors for obesity are persistent. We often see this sex disparity in physical activity, where you see that in terms of high levels of activity, the girls are usually lower than the boys. So a lot more are low and inactive. And that starts from a very early age. And that regardless of whether you're a boy or a girl, the prevalence of things like good intake of fruits and vegetables is very low. And these are data from the Youth Risk and Resiliency Survey. So one of the things that we have found is that several times when interventions are being done in children, even school-based interventions, they have not really been very successful. They may produce some short-term effects, but they're not really helpful in the long term. And because of that, people are thinking about earlier and earlier interventions. So there have been a number of interventions in mothers who are pre-pregnancy, in pregnancy, to see if you can actually try and reduce the risk of overweight, obesity as children are born. But then there is a lot more interest now in the infancy period, because that's now considered a critical window. We know there's a lot of things about genetics, so we know that genetically you may be predisposed to being overweight or obese, but whether or not your genetic potential is expressed will be dependent on a number of things. A lot of emphasis has been placed on the intrauterine environment, so we know that mothers who have diabetes, their children are more likely to have diabetes, to be overweight. If you have micronutrient deficiencies, so those who have gone through war or famine, those children are more predisposed to other conditions as they get older. But there's a lot more emphasis now in the window outside of just that prenatal period to the early life exposure. And we believe that a lot of plasticity is still present up to about age 2, where with the right influences, you can actually change the child's trajectory or try to do things to change the trajectory in terms of health. So you want to promote healthy growth without excessive fat accumulation. And that is actually one of the things which is quite interesting. We know that some children are born at a disadvantage. These are data that Dr. Ferguson had looked at, looking at parental socioeconomic status and the likelihood of central obesity. It was more pronounced in girls. So they're less skilled, your parents were in terms of occupation, the higher likelihood of central obesity. And then when you looked at education again, particularly for girls, not so pronounced for boys, the less educated the parents were, we find that there is a higher likelihood of the child being overweight. And so the emphasis on this first 1,000 days, the prenatal, which is 270 days, and then the first 2 years of life, is something that people are very excited about, because they believe, or the belief is, that just looking at the health of the mother and looking at the parent-child unit in the very first 2 years of life is very critical, because hopefully with the right influences at that time, you can actually change the trajectory. And we know that it has effects, if depending on the interventions, you can not just be looking at physical health, but we know definitely from work we have done, improvements in cognition and other things, less violence and more pro-social behavior, you can have a lot more long-term effects from early life interventions. So this was a schematic we had done some time ago when we were looking at what we were using as our theme for the Institute in terms of sociobiologic determinants. We know that when children are overweight, they're more likely to remain overweight, progress into adulthood, and develop chronic diseases. We know there are a lot of things that will influence the likelihood of the child being overweight, starting with the parent in terms of the parental education, maternal mental health, maternal nutrition, family history, social circumstances. But also within the first few years of life, there are a lot of other influences that come into play. And those are the ones that we're actually a lot more interested in. So this is what our study is going to be about. We're calling it Parenting and Growth in Caribbean Children. And for a long time, we've been doing a lot of interventions in parents to improve parenting practices. But we actually want to see if some of these interventions could have benefits in terms of physical health, and also whether some of the traditional interventions we have used before can be modified to include messages which might be helpful to reduce the child's risk of obesity as they grow. So the concept of this sort of postnatal critical period was highlighted a couple of years ago with an NIH consensus statement or conference that had a lot of data on the role of antenatal influences on birth weight and risk of obesity, but they were finding that there are a lot of gaps when you're looking at issues of what happens in the first 2 years of life and how does that relate to the risk of overweight obesity. And also the fact that a number of the things that we have traditionally purported as being beneficial, the evidence was not there. So things like exclusive breastfeeding, the evidence is still a little spotty, some studies supporting it, some not. Issues of delaying introduction of solid foods, which is a very strong recommendation. So exclusive breastfeeding or delaying solids wasn't necessarily producing the effects. And then also a number of studies which had been trying to intervene in the prenatal or antenatal period, they were actually not showing the benefits that they'd expected to see in the postnatal period. So helping us to think more about that specific or critical window. And so we know there are a number of things that could be modified in that period, things around nutrition in terms of breastfeeding. We spoke about introduction of foods or choices of foods, introducing children to certain types of foods where tastes and preferences might be developed. We know that parenting feeding styles can have a very strong influence on the child's likelihood of developing overweight obesity. So we talk about non-responsive and responsive feeding styles. So responsive feeding styles where you're cued by the child's responses that you don't overfeed or withhold food unnecessary. And then we understand more that the environment, that immediate environment within which a child comes can influence the child's weight trajectory. In particularly, routines that are done within the household, as well as even things like the family structure, whether the father is present or not. And one of the things which is very interesting is that even though children are operating in the same environment, there are specific effects of the environment which are not the same in boys and girls. So a boy and a girl growing up in the same structure will not be affected similarly. And so what they find is that for the girl, family conflict or unhealthy diet is more likely to result in that child making unhealthy food choices. Or restrictive feeding, where the parent may withhold food because they're concerned about the child getting too big or overweight, actually results in girls having poor eating patterns where they'll eat even when they're not hungry. And we know that girls are less likely to be physically active even when facilities are there. There may be a lot of cultural things, but the fact that you have a play field or facilities for activity or exercise, they're still less likely to engage in physical activity than the boys. And then we also know that if you're looking at impacts of interventions, physical activity interventions seem to be more beneficial in boys and less beneficial in girls. And that fathers' physical activity patterns have a stronger influence on the boys than on the girls. So we know that there are differences in the environments and people's response, whether some of it is cultural, whether some of it is biological. because the hormonal interplay and timing of puberty and so on are very different, whether it's genetic, because there seem to be some genes which are more specific to boys and girls when you're looking at mechanisms of obesity. These are things that still need to be teased out. But some of those factors may not be modifiable. So if we're looking at public health interventions, we really want to look at things that we think we can adjust. And so Dr. Copeland would have been the one who gave approval for us to go into the clinics about almost 5 years ago, 6 years ago now, where Sue Walker had gone in to do an intervention, parenting interventions. They've been doing them for a long time, mainly focused in high-risk children, but now they're beginning to try and integrate it into routine clinic visits. So interventions and messages that are given to the children when they come in for immunization schedule. So we jumped in on this project to see if we could also begin to explore some of these early infancy factors that might be related to weight. So it's part of a larger study involving Jamaica, Antigua, and St. Lucia with mother-child pairs. We have a lot of data from the mothers because for their interventions, they're interested in maternal characteristics, including their educational achievement, depressive symptoms, and home environment. And then we added in a number of questions at 1 year looking at patterns or behaviors of things that we think may influence likelihood of weight within that period, including things like feeding styles, breastfeeding duration, timing of intervention, timing of introduction of other foods, TV time, even though we say television watching, but time in front of a television, sleeping time and arrangements, and we also had measures of anthropometry. So at 18 months, when the first phase of the study was completed and the money was out, we actually looked at how some of these factors might have influenced the likelihood of their weight. What we did find, just from preliminary analysis, that mothers who had higher depressive symptoms were more likely to have smaller children. This is a little different from what we see in other settings like the US, but it's kind of consistent with what is seen in a lot of developing countries in terms of the relationship between depression and weight. And then again, when we looked at things like parental occupation, we find that where the parents are better skilled, we find that there's a lower likelihood of the child being overweight at that age, and the father's presence was associated with a lower likelihood of overweight as well. We looked at feeding styles. So one of the things about feeding styles is that no mother displays just one feeding style all the time. Depending on what's happening, they may be using different styles. I'm not going to explain all of them, but I'll explain a few that we did see. So there's uninvolved, where the parent doesn't pay a lot of attention to what the child is eating or have a lot of interest. Restrictive, where the parent may actually withhold food, prevent the child from getting too big. Indulgent, where the child's whims or demands are met very easily. Forceful, where the parent insists that the plate be finished or that they don't leave until the food is done. And then responsive, which is what we really want to see, which is the ideal, where you're taking cues and interacting, very interactive feeding, especially in that first period of life when you're dependent on visual cues and other cues for your understanding. So we looked at maternal characteristics and the feeding styles, and we found that mothers who had a lot of depressive symptoms were more likely to have a lot of the non-responsive feeding styles. So those are the ones that we don't like to encourage. And then those with lower education were also more likely to display a lot more of the non-responsive feeding styles. Of all the feeding styles, we didn't find the responsive feeding style very beneficial in terms of weight, but we're going to see if that still holds as the children get older. Looking at some of the other things, introduction of sweetened beverages and so on, TV time, sleep time. Sleep time looks as though it might be beneficial. So the longer the child has to sleep, maybe an easy message that we could sell to encourage improvements if we can show a benefit from better sleep patterns at a very early age, maybe a good one to look at. As part of the study, we also did some focus group work using an established discussion guide in rural and urban mothers of infants, and just kind of looking at what are the things that will determine how mothers feed and what are the messages that will kind of guide them in terms of how they practice their parenting. So instinct in Jamaican mothers was a very strong determinant of how they would would manage foods, that they were dependent on what they had learned through their own experience or their own gut feelings. The fathers, when present, were often very strong proponents of healthy diets, so mothers would hide the banana chips where the fathers around, or they would breastfeed. The fathers would not allow them not to breastfeed. So apparently the messages go through to the fathers and are strongly enforced in the home. The mothers use a lot of physical cues to guide in terms of their how much they should feed the child. When they're looking at whether some of the things we're talking about could have influenced their risk of overweight, there are some foods that they recognize very easily, like fatty foods and so on, but other things they didn't think outside of eating were important drivers of weight or obesity. TV was thought to be very beneficial, so any messages around TV will have to be carefully coached. Everybody said this is the best thing, and how good the videos were, so we know we're not going to touch that one. The issue about sleep, whether related to weight, was something that was really unknown, so a lot of parents didn't see any relationship between that and weight, and they still do look to healthcare providers as well as persons in the community to help to guide them in terms of how they parent. And the setting, the interventions will depend on settings. So we're thinking about whether a rural and urban mother, we'll have to take those things into consideration in deciding how messages should best be given. So this last slide just talks a little bit about what we're going to do. We're actually hoping to bring them back in now that they're turning 5 or 6. We had hoped to bring them in before, but we weren't very successful with our first round, but hopefully it'll be better in our second round or maybe our third round. But we actually are now going to kind of move beyond the home environment, because the children are actually about to begin their school experience. So they may have been in preschool or basic school, they're now going into primary school. So this will be a very exciting time, because we now want to begin to look at the home and the school environment and how they're interacting to result in different effects. We're going to be a lot more detailed in some of the things that we're measuring. So we're going to be looking at the things we'd measured before and relate them to not just weight, but more accurate measurement of body composition. So we'll know percent fat and fat mass. And then we also want to do more aggressive or objective measures of diet through biomarker measurements, as well as physical activity through accelerometry. And then we'll look at the patterns as they go through the next few years. Hopefully by the time they're 10 and leaving school, if we get enough money, we'll see them right through. And then we'll be able to kind of begin to understand which interventions we should begin thinking about when we're trying to address the obesity epidemic. It's a mixed method study. So we'll be combining it with some focus group work as well, with the early life things that we're beginning to see emerging from the data, as well as we want to look at patterns. So we'll be actually deliberately looking out for children whose growth trajectory is ideal. So in other words, what is it about that home that allows a child to maintain a healthy weight, or where the child's growth trajectory improves? So they were overweight, and then for whatever reason they move back into a normal level. And I think those deviants, as they say, positive deviants, will be a group of persons that we can kind of understand and learn more about how we can intervene in this whole obesity epidemic. So I think that's where I'm going to end it, and I hand over to our last speaker. Thanks.
Thank you, Prof. Our final speaker also did his undergraduate medical and postgraduate studies in dermatology at UWI. He's a graduate with distinction from the Institute of Dermatology in the UK. His avant-garde research and publications has focused mainly on confluent and reticulate papillomatosis, for which he has received on several occasions the Professor H. Williams Award from the Dermatology Association of the Caribbean. He's a much sought speaker regionally and internationally, and so UDOP is really honored to have this distinguished lecturer and consultant dermatologist, Dr. Michael Fitzhenley, to present to us on obesity and the skin. Show some love to the doctor for me.
I'm starting my timer. Thank you very much for that very, very kind introduction. Now, You're a wonderful audience to see so many people here. I really didn't expect to see so many, but I can tell why. You're all my friends, so thank you. Thank you, friends, for staying around to the bitter end. I even said I was going to do a BMI study on those who stayed and those who went for early dinner, but I decided that may be too, you know, much of a problem. Then the other thing I said, I really should have two pointers so I could, each screen could get an idea of what's happening. But for the purposes, I'll just be using the screen over on my left whenever I need to use a pointer. So I want to thank the organizers so much for inviting me to come and give the opportunity to give this talk today about obesity and the skin. I must tell you that the talk actually has changed compared to how in the past 5 hours I actually tweeted. I was going to do mostly, it was obesity and stroke CRP. Prof Barker earlier did such an excellent talk that he actually covered most of the things, and I said, oh grief, if these good friends are going to stay to the bitter end, I can't rehash the same thing. So I said, okay, 1/3 for the obesity and 2/3 for CRP, because how many people have seen anything called CRP? Confluent and reticulate, wonderful. It's worth your staying, and excellent, excellent, excellent. No conflicts of interest, and these are the topics that we said that we will be speaking about. Of course, we all know what obesity is, and it has been rehashed today. So we took our latest findings from this population review journal, which is called the Daily Observer newspaper, in March 29th, which stated that that obesity had increased from 45% in 2002, almost 1% per year, to 60% in 2016, and these figures were stated more or less earlier today. Now, doctors of whatever gender are not exempt from the condition. Here are some people who are speaking knowingly. Well, guess what happened, though? So sometimes we have doctors like this, whatever gender, and you know, they come in and they have this kind of a look, and you kind of wonder, something went wrong with the slides, but it's okay, we'll just press on. I'll just press on. But of course, something had to be wrong, because women have a gynoid thing, and the men have the more android look. Social norms are a factor. So when he was talking about beating this obesity thing, we have to decide how people want to look. And I hope this is not called sexist in any way, a single woman, a married woman, and a good old divorced lady. Then the men, single man, the rooster in the yard, the married man, and my God, the divorced duck chicken. So we have to bear this in mind. When patients come in and they want to get rid of the dark mark between the thighs, that it's due to rubbing. I said, hello, I could give you the magic cream to take it off, but unless you take off, the weight is gonna come back. You know, but they like the look, so that's a problem. There are different things we could speak about, obesity on the skin, but I wanted to mention some of these from the Bologna text. Hyperhidrosis, that many will see that a lot of obese patients actually sweat a lot, and this is thought partly due to this amount of fat that they have, and you know, the necessity of losing heat, and this and that and that and so on. So that can be part of it. Plantar hyperkeratosis, which means thickening of the sole, especially the posterior heel. They'll have thickness in that area, and that's directly related to the weight itself. The other things we will mention in a little while, and they were covered earlier as well. This thing about insulin resistance, it was listed as being the most common skin manifestation for obesity. 74% of obese patients had acanthosis nigricans with elevated insulin levels. And it's thought that increased insulin decreases the functional insulin receptors, which puts a shift to binding to insulin growth factor receptors instead, and this led to acanthosis nigricans. Because acanthosis nigricans, even though it looks dark, it's not actually pigment, it's actually thickness of skin because of the growth of the skin. So for those who don't remember, you get this velvety hyperpigmentation around the neck, you can get it underneath the arm, you get it in the groin, you get it in the elbows, you can get it on the knuckles, you can get it on the face, and many people mix this up with melasma, but that is actually acanthosis nigricans. The hyperinsulinemia also increases the ovarian androgens and can lead to hirsutism and acne. Can be polycystic ovarian syndrome related and often associated with these acrocordons or skin tags due to the impaired carbohydrate metabolism that we see. So these tags on the neck and in the flexures and so on. Oh, good Lord. Wrong talk, got saved. It's okay, we'll press on. The keratosis pilaris can also be associated with obesity. And for those who don't know, these are these spiny little bumpy things around the hair follicles, especially seen in those who put on weight. Even regular young people, once they reach the teenage years, this thing tends to come on as well. The hyperandrogenism can also be associated with those who have the increased adipose tissue because it synthesizes testosterone. And the hyperinsulinemia increases the production of ovarian androgens. So they hope they can get virilism because of just being obese. And the last phrase is also useful, that the facial hirsutism can be associated with BMI independent of testosterone. So people with obesity, very often we see them with the hirsutism and other features of virilism, and that's something to note. The striae was discussed earlier, and I know you'd love me to tell you the secret recipe to take out stretch marks, but not tonight. We'll talk about that afterwards. Lymphedema, circulation problems. The chronic venous insufficiency, the stasis dermatitis, which you see the arrow, lipodermatosclerosis, which you see also, and the venous ulceration. But this paper came up just earlier, 2 weeks ago, where it was pointed out there's an obesity-related angiosarcoma, which comes up in patients who have lymphedema. And it may be hard to pick up because those morbidly obese patients have so many folds on the tummy that these vascular lesions are hidden, and very often they don't want you pulling apart those areas and looking, and sometimes it can be missed, but this can be a fatal thing. So this is another thing to think about, which has just been highlighted just 2 weeks ago. Cellulite, we'll not go more into that. That's not lipoatrophy, but that's good old cellulite. Other things that can be aggravated, they include the intertrigo, the candida, the erythrasma that was mentioned earlier, and the intertrigo, which is the chafing in the flexures, and that was mentioned earlier as well. What is of importance to note is that when skin is normally acidic, the pH gets higher, it's alkaline in skin folds of people who are over 25 BMI. Candida likes higher BMIs. So this could be another reason why we get the candidiasis in these obese patients. So we need to lower our BMI, lower the pH, get it back to acidic, and we may actually be solving some of this problem. Easier said than done. Candidiasis, which was mentioned earlier as well, but these satellite lesions, if you see these red erythematous papules around these flexural areas, think about candida and treat for candida. That's a sign. Same thing here. Can see the white film, but don't forget these satellite lesions, which can be a good sign for candidiasis. Males, balanitis, and this can be even the presenting sign for diabetes. Erythrasma was mentioned earlier due to Carinibacterium minutissimum, and again, we'll not say much more about that, it was mentioned. We'd like to emphasize that obesity is a risk factor for tinea pedis and onychomycosis, and it can be a portal of entry for the serious foot infections that was mentioned earlier today about the diabetic foot. So please don't take these things as just totally aesthetic. It's very important to be treated in your obese patients and your patients at risk for diabetes. Hidradenitis suppurativa was mentioned earlier as well, and this is another example of it in the axilla, and obesity seems somehow related to this factor as well. Patient with gout, we had a patient like this recently who had this nodule on the ear, and that was tophaceous gout. So remember, this can be something to look about, and it can be associated with obesity as well. Psoriasis was mentioned, and this was Prof. Barker's favorite topic earlier today. And just to emphasize what was said, it's firmly established with the metabolic syndrome, that's psoriasis. Psoriasis is a risk factor for cardiovascular disease, MI, CVAs. So all those who see psoriasis or recognize it, like these noted cardiologists in the audience who love dermatology, make sure that you, when you see the psoriasis, you investigate them. This was one of my favorite slides. This might even help with some of the discussions that was being mentioned earlier about the link between obesity and the psoriasis. Why do I like it? Because what it shows in the pathogenesis, which is a Th1-driven disease, these cytokines are similar to the cytokines which are present in the metabolic syndrome. No wonder now then when you're treating with these TNF-alpha inhibitors, you're getting improvements in the cardiovascular risk factors and decreasing your MIs. It's wonderful stuff. And of course, the skin has led the way, as always, in educating people about these things. To summarize this section before I do a rapid run through of CRP, this summarizes the data. For those statistically inclined persons, this was significant that they did a comparative study, things that are associated with obesity statistically, striae, the plantar hyperkeratosis, the TAGS, the intertrigo, the pseudoacanthosis nigricans, keratosis pilaris, lymphedema, bacterial infections. And the pseudoacanthosis nigricans and bacterial infections were also found to be correlated with the degree of obesity. And so recognizing these things can and guide our management in helping obese patients to get rid of these things. So what is CRP? It's a long journey, and I'm only going to help you in a little bit of the up and downs that we went through over the years. Can't tell you the whole story today because we have, I have 8 minutes on my timer. It's a long story, so I'm just going to give you a summary to explain. It started once in Trinidad. I went down and I showed this thing, and we call it lichenified seborrheic dermatitis on the chest. And Dr. Sweet, who would have been here, said, but that's CRP. I said, what on earth are you talking about? Because this is what we're calling it. A lot of people didn't recognize this thing. A typical case comes in like this. A 17-year-old female, she has this rash for 3 to 4 years. Thoughts, liver spots. So they go and they get treated for liver spots. Because chances are most of you in the audience have seen this condition and didn't recognize what it was. And you have been calling it resistant liver spots or something of that nature. So they thought it was liver spots. Poor response to treatment. The patient is overweight. They have acanthosis nigricans. And that's CRP. Another one. She has sebderm. She has acanthosis nigricans, 180 pounds in 2002. She returned in 2010 weighing 220 pounds and says she has this brown rash on her chest. When she pulls her chest, what does she have? This is CRP. Okay. So what is CRP? Well, confluent and reticulate papillomatosis. Make sure you put the A in the right spot. I don't want you to go away saying that the appetizer before your dinner was CRAP. It's confluent and reticulate papillomatosis. Gujiro and Kato identified this in 2027 and classified it into three things, and the CRP is the one in the center. Prof. Davis in 2006 from Mayo tried to have a new definition, but one of the definitions was to make sure that it did not respond to antifungals but had an excellent response to minocycline. So if you think something is liver spots, you're not sure, or you think it's CRP, try minocycline. That's the message you can leave after this. Everything else is just brought on. So what does it look like? Why is it called this? Confluent in the center. There it is. And reticulate or web shape, mesh-shaped at the periphery. That's why it has this name, confluent in the center. Here it is again. Confluent in the center, reticulate, mesh-shaped at the periphery. Here it is up close. Confluent in the center, reticulate at the periphery. Look good. You are going to see this condition before the year ends once you're seeing a lot of patients. They have this powdery deposit on the skin, and it can spread into the axilla. Some people think CRP and acanthosis nigricans is the same, but if you look, you can see the acanthosis nigricans, you can see the CRP invading into it. They look different clinically. Here it is, it expands down along the trunk like this, and you're going to think this was liver spots. It comes into the antecubital fossa as well, and we see this fairly often as well. People call this a rare disease. So I was saying to Prof, lead speaker this afternoon, have you seen this condition in London? No, we don't see it. I mean, all textbooks say it's rare, and it is. It says rare, rare, rare. But this doctor in 1981 said, maybe we're not recognizing it. At the Mayo Clinic, they had the largest cohort in the world. World. 39 cases in 30 years. And they see 50,000 patients per annum. And they collected 39 in 30 years. So everybody was saying it's real. So what's the incidence? Well, we have to thank our noted Costas in 2003 that she published in the International Journal of Dermatology, Dr. Donwell, who is here with us. And she showed that CRP was 11th or most or 12th most common diagnosis. And in fact, I was going to say to Prof Barker, sorry to tell you, but CRP is more common than psoriasis in Jamaica. And so this is something of serious interest. In the Caribbean, I asked my colleagues from the different islands, do you see CRP? Yes, we all see it. We see it every month. We see it almost every week. But it's called rare. Part of it is our fault. We haven't published enough. So this is one, if you say I haven't done anything, 2010, Dutch literature, but there's an English translation. Google CRP, Fitzhenley, you'll find a nice little thing that says that it really is not that uncommon after all, and we tell more than what we can say today. Today is just the icing on the thing. It's usually in teens, going up to their 30s, and we hardly ever see this in an elderly patient at all. I'm going to go even faster before the chairman takes me off. Females, males, about 2 to 1. In our studies, it was about equal. Blacks to whites, 2 to 1. In our studies, 100 to 1. We saw no Caucasians with this problem out here. The association with acanthosis nigricans was recognized from the 1990s. It also has been our personal experience. Some question whether CRP is a form of acanthosis nigricans or if acanthosis nigricans is a local form of CRP. You'll see how I showed the pictures that seem to indicate that this condition is perhaps different. Endocrinopathies have been associated. So in the literature, it has been there, 2010, abnormal glucose tolerance, diabetes, that's why we're talking about it today. Thyroid disease, and you see the endocrinologists, I'm glad they're all here and listening out and so on. It's in Japan, well, but in many, Dr. Schwartz, very prolific writer, says many times no endocrine changes. I haven't seen much of the endocrine changes. So here it is, again, the same thing showing the CRP, which is the smaller dark things, invading into the acanthosis nigricans. Here are some of my patients. This is the one that we showed. This is it. She clearly has acanthosis nigricans. You can see that. Here's another one. He has CRP on his chest. Here he has his acanthosis nigricans, a different patient I showed you. Okay, another one who has it on the knuckles, on the back, has it on the neck, has it underneath the arm. This rare, by the way, I'm showing you some rare conditions, but it's just a weekly thing for us. Chest, these patients are obese, and they have this condition. Under the arm, face, back. I hope you all see this condition exists. And this treatment, to show you before treatment, after treatment with something like minocycline, on the back, before treatment, after treatment, minocycline, I can predict to them, I say, 2 to 3 weeks, I can promise you this thing is going to start melting off your skin. It's actually one of the nicest things to treat. They do very well. This slide helps to show us that it is not just related to fungus or liver spots, because this patient had treatment with minocycline, had this amount of lesion left back. So you might say, oh, we didn't do a good job. But this was liver spots, and then it cleared with pityriasis versicular treatment. So the conditions are actually separate, and not just one, and it's, CRP is not mainly a fungus problem. I'm stuck, sir. Oh, here's another treatment, before and after. There are some more recent studies on it that shows the same thing related to diabetes, and they talk about the link, and the same thing about the insulin and the growth factors, and so on. Insulin growth factors and so on. They're still with this CRP is a rare disease. Yeah, this is not the corrected talk, my apologies. And associated with various endocrine disorders, more of the same. that last study showed the improvement in a patient who they just put on diet only. So that was instructive. You cut down the caloric intake of the patient and the CRP began to improve. So I think the whole area is so fascinating and interesting. I tell you, you all will just love this thing. Yeah, before and after with diet. In closing, I have about 30 seconds, show you a short little thing that just tell you a definitive study that we did some years ago for about over four months with CRP, we collected 17 patients, 4 months. And the sex incidence was about the same and so on and so on. We're not going to go through it. The pattern was pretty similar to other countries. So what we did was then we went on to do a one-year study. And we had 42 patients, sex incidence almost about the same, and so on. And so when you look at this, which is relatively rare condition, so they took 39 in 30 years. We collected 42 patients in one calendar year, and we presented this at meetings in the past. So we theoretically at the time, we think had the largest cohort of patients in the entire world, because it is not rare in Jamaica. We know Jamaica first again. You know the story. And lastly, this year we said, okay, coming up to this meeting, and I'm finishing now. So we saw 6 new patients for this year. 6. What month are we in? April. So we looked at them. Look at these interesting lines here. Acanthosis nigricans, all 6. BMIs, 27, 32, 28, 31, 28, 41. And we close with showing these are the examples. Patient 1, patient 2, patient 3, and to remind you, patient 4, patient 5, patient 6. Hello, this is a real condition. You all have to be seeing it somewhere or the other, maybe not just calling it what it is. So in summary, we've given this quick overview of CRP, C-A-R-P, don't say it the other way around, please, and the definite association with our patients with weight and obesity. A lot more work is needed. A lot more people need to publish in this area, including those who are speaking, so it can be properly in the literature. It's, again, an uncorrected copy. We have over 169 patients in our, let's call it our database or registry. One day, again, we'll be looking, we'll try and do more work on this. But it may give us new thoughts on pathophysiologic mechanisms in the skin. We may find some new organisms. Why does minocyclin work? You know, it's not an inflammatory condition. It's a lot of things to talk about. But I think it's the end for now, until one day we get some more data. Thank you for listening. Thank you for staying. Have a good evening.
This session ends momentarily, but not before I thank the 3 speakers for their very erudite presentations, and you for continuing to stay with us until the very end.